I was praying to ask the Lord about what to share tonight, praise the Lord. And it connects with probably one of the greatest testimonies that I've heard in the whole time, 37 years of being saved, that was shared with me a few weeks ago at a time when I needed to hear it too as well. Amen. One person you know that's not with us tonight, that was with us in every service we did together, was Pastor David. Amen. He went on to be with the Lord. Praise God. Thank you so much for your prayers and just coming and being a blessing. Praise God. He loved my father's house, Covenant Ministry Center. Amen. And, you know, we miss him dearly, but praise God, he's gone on to receive his reward. But during that time, I was contacted by a family that had moved away several years ago that were parts of our ministry. They had moved to California to take care of their mother. Their mother had grown quite ill, and they wanted to go and be with her so that they could see about her. Well, when they did get back to California, that she began to progressively get worse, to the point of not maybe a life-threatening situation at first, but she began to lose all of her memory, all of it. And how many of y'all know that's a painful thing when you go see mama and mama don't know who you are? And it was just tearing at their hearts. And she was admitted to a facility, and they would go in and talk to her. She had no idea who they were. And the more that they would try to get her to remember, the worse it was. She just couldn't put it together. Well, this is the testimony that they gave me, probably one of the most remarkable things I've ever heard. The young lady who was her daughter, she heard God speak to her one day when they was going out to the parking lot. And she said that the Lord spoke to her and said, get a tape player and bring the tape player to the room and instruct the people to keep it on repeat. Y'all know how it just keeps playing? And just let it play. And he told her what to get. Well, she had been around things of God, so she felt like first thing he was going to get her to get was a healing tape of healing scriptures. But the Lord didn't tell her to do it that way. The Lord just said to her, get the Bible on tape, bring it in her room, and just let it play. Just let it play. Don't comment on it. Don't nothing. Just let it play. Just let it play. Day and night, just let it play. When they're not treating her, let it play. So she, in obedience to the Lord, did that, brought it in, and she just happened to have some people that, you know, would make sure that it just stayed on and stayed on and stayed on and stayed on and stayed on. All the way from Genesis to Revelation, just playing the Word. Just playing the Word. How many of y'all know that the Word is like a medicine? Amen. I mean, do you really believe that? Praise God. Well, this went on for some months, and she just let it play, let it play, let it play. But she said one day when she went into the place just to sit with her, because they weren't communicating up to that point, and she said that she was sitting in the chair. Now, it had been months since she was able to recognize who she was. So her mother woke up and looked over at her and said, she called her by her name. And she said that she almost fell out of the chair because she just couldn't understand how she was gaining her memory back. She said she called her by her name. And then she began to ask her, where am I? What's been going on with me? And she began to try to tell her what it was. And she didn't think she remembered any of it. But then she said when she went back a few days later that her mother was telling her about the conversation they had 3 days ago. And her memory was coming back so fast, so quick, that the doctors had determined that it wasn't as serious as they thought that it might have been. Hello, somebody. And when they told her that, they said, because it's nothing, and here's what they said that's so remarkable about this. It says that there's nothing that we have done, even in the treatment, that should have caused her to get her memory back. Well, the daughter told me something we did some months ago, that we flooded this room with the Word. Y'all hear this testimony? And we're talking about somebody that was close to their 90s. And they said, we flooded this room with her, with the Word. And they said, well, she's getting parts of her memory back. And you know, they begin to tell him, no, she ain't getting parts. She's going to get it all back. And they said, and not only that, here's one of the other remarkable places where there had been extreme sickness in this lady's body. Somehow, some way, the sicknesses began to regress. They began to back down. They began to go away. And she said one of the glorious things that she did, she said when she went in the room one day, and her mother was sitting in a chair telling the people around her about some of the ways that she had acted when she was a little girl. She said her memory just didn't get restored. She said her memory got so restored that she could remember when the daughter was a little girl, 5, 6, 7 years old, and she was telling them about how she used to act. Y'all hear what I'm saying? We live in a day and time where people are minimizing or trying to take away what God's word and the power of God's word can do. But I'm telling you, when I heard this testimony, I realized something. Praise God. God's word has the ability to change any situation. Yes, that's true. But it also has the ability to change the insides of you. The way you think, the way you reason, the way you talk, the way you walk, what you have your desires placed on. God's word has the ability to transform your entire life. If we would believe it. Somebody say amen. I'm telling people now, and I'm making it really plain. Praise God. What God's word is truth does is it brings freedom. When truth comes, the Bible says, you will know the truth and the truth will do something for you. Okay, say it again. So how many of y'all know that the entrance of truth should bring freedom to your life? Now, I know some of you have been running this journey for a long time. Some of you have been trusting God for a long time. Ain't that right? But now ain't the time to stop now. If there's ever a time that we should put the emphasis on God's word, it's now more than ever before. We're living in days and we're living in times where people have ran out of answers. Our country right now, this nation, knows that it can't trust in the political reasonings of men. It can't trust in what people tell you from day to day. We got to have something greater than a particular party that we're looking to. We got to have the party of the word of God and everything that it says. And I don't know about you. I had an idea the other day, and I'm in the process of getting it. Praise God. God has placed us in the inner city. Several of our ministers are here. Thank God for you being here with us too. But I've had this word. When I heard that testimony, and I heard that even in the latest stage of dementia, latest stage of Alzheimer's, that God's word put her mind back together. When I heard that testimony, I said, you know what? Praise God. We go out and we talk about we're a church without walls. I said, but I wonder what would happen if all of a sudden you had a little van and had a little microphone loudspeaker and just hooked up the word and just started driving through neighborhoods. Well, if they can bring the ice cream truck through your neighborhood like that, how come we can't take the word? Well, they got the ice cream truck coming through playing their melody. What would happen if you started taking the word through a neighborhood, through an area? The change that would, y'all said y'all believe the word is real. The change that could take place. We've already seen great change already by the word in neighborhoods. The murder rate going down. Ministering, seeing men, young men and people coming from various places, various gangs, and God beginning to set them free. This is what you hold in your hand tonight. You hold this in your hand. You carry it to church. You talk about it. You've got it at home. You got it in your car. But my question tonight is, do you believe it? Hallelujah. Amen. Do you believe it? Do you believe that it does what it says it does? Do you believe that it can manifest what it says it can? What I've had to ask God to do with many believers that I meet is to help them overcome the realm of unbelief. How many of you know that unbelief is a constant, even though a stranger that shows up around you all the time. Come in church, you hear the powerful word of God, before you can get to the parking lot, here comes unbelief to throw holes in it. Yes, it's always got a three-letter word behind everything the word tells you, and that's but. B-U-T. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Yes, God can heal me, but. Yes, God can deliver me, but. Yes, God can save my children, but. You know what we have to do? We got to get the but out. And we've got to remove it from our lives because God's word, and that's what I'm going to talk about just a little while. Praise God. And I want you to open your Bibles to Romans chapter 12, if you would. That sets up where I'm going. Praise the Lord. Anybody living on the word? Yes. Trusting in the word? Yes. Amen. This is your strength. This is your foundation. This is your life. This is your peace. This is your hope. Hallelujah. Does anybody believe that our country's in need of a revival of the word of God? Yes. Thank you, Lord God. Amen. I want to go to Romans chapter 12. This is nothing you've never heard. I just want to exhort you with this word. Praise God. One great thing you do have here, you have great preaching, teaching in this body. Amen. And I thank God that we're not afraid to teach out of the Bible. Y'all say, well, everybody's doing that. No, they're not either. I'm going places. And I'm seeing people that don't read this anymore. Many, many are moving away from it because they don't want to be considered to be religiously intolerant. They don't want to be seen to be biased. So they stay away from certain passages of Scripture because they don't want anybody to think that they're homophobic or that they are trying to judge other people. But how many of you know that if it's anything going to set you free, it's what you hold in your hand right now is the word of God. Now, I'm going to read these scriptures, and I'm just going to read some other ones with you tonight because we're going to talk about the power of transformation. Can you say that? The power of transformation. Hallelujah. In verse 1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And look at the exhortation in verse 2. Be not conformed to this world. Don't think like the world. Don't act like the world. Don't be fashioned like the world. That's what conformity is. Don't be shaped like the world. Don't be framed like the world. Don't think like the world. So if I'm not going to be conformed to this world, why would I be going to the world to get counsel or the world to find out what is going to take place in our land in these days? Many times people in church can hear a word from God and doubt it and turn on the TV and listen to a word from a newscaster and believe it with all their heart. Don't make no difference if he made it up. Don't make no difference if he's exaggerating. Don't make any difference if he's biased. They believe it because he's on TV. Hello, somebody. So the Bible says in second verse, be not conformed to this world. But it tells us to do something. Are you with me? But be ye what? Say it again. Transform. Say it again. Transform. Now I want you to ask the person beside you, are you being transformed? What they say? Amen. Help them. Help them. Are you being transformed? Now, it's getting ready to tell you how. Be ye transformed, read it with me, by what? By the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. I can't prove the good, acceptable, and perfect will of God unless I allow my mind to be renewed and the power of transformation to take place in my life. Now, there are many voices that are in the land right now that are speaking on every hand. You and I are being exhorted to live a life of being transformed rather than conformed. Now, I want to give you something. I want you to turn to Philippians 2, praise God, because I want to give you a little bit of a look at a transformed mind. Just in case you may think you've got one, let's just go ahead and examine it, would you? Would you do that with me? Praise God. Because I want to see and I want to walk in the power of transformation. We are now beginning to witness people calling on the body of Christ from every walk of life, calling on us in the areas of substance abuse, calling on us in the areas of healing and diseases, miracles that are needed and signs and wonders. And we are believing that this is the greatest hour that you and I have been brought to. God's been teaching us and training us, hallelujah, and he has been preparing us for such a time as this. And because he has been preparing us for this time, you and me, you and I, we are now ready to release even some of the things we were singing about. We're ready to release to mankind, the mighty one of Israel. I'm going to give y'all something that's going to become more than a song. Hello, somebody. That's going to have a reality in our lives today. The mighty one of Israel. Now, I want to go to Philippians 2, praise God, because I want to look at the transformed mind. And it's quite plain, and I want to, I'll start with verse 4. Are you there? Say amen. Look not every man on his own things, but every man also on the things of others. Now, it's getting ready to tell you, remember that it told us to go through the process of the renewing of the mind. How does the mind look? How does it begin to look when it is being renewed? Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation. Stop right there. Thank God, God is delivering us from trying to have reputations. Oh, y'all ain't saying that now. We are now beginning to see that God is unfolding by his power and delivering and breaking off and exposing the celebrity status, the reputation, the high esteem, especially that many in the ministry desired to have. It's no longer working. It is what it is, and it shows up for what it is. We are called not to try to establish reputations. What we do in our churches today, it's not done so that people can notice us. It should be done so that they'll notice Jesus. Hello? Now, if they are centering on you and I, how many of y'all know that we've done the wrong job? Everything that we do should point somebody to Jesus, not me. So we are seeing this reputation syndrome begin to be broken. What is it being replaced with? Praise God. And I might be preaching some of this by faith. Made himself of no reputation. Took upon him the form of what? Say it again. So when the mind is being renewed, it no longer seeks to be noticed, seeks to be applauded, seeks to be appreciated, seeks to be lifted up, seeks to be bragged on. It no longer has that for desire. If nobody ever tells you how good you preach or how good you sing, you don't care anyway, because what you were doing was under the Lord anyway. If nobody has this, I tell people this all the time. I want to encourage people, but I can't stand behind people all day long telling them how great they are, telling them how much we need them all the time. I can't do that. It don't work for me. Either you're doing what you're doing unto the Lord, or I may miss you one Sunday, and then you're going to be mad for the next week. How many of y'all know that if you ain't seeking a reputation, you don't have to be applauded. You don't have to be appreciated. You don't have to be sought out. You don't have to be put on a pedestal. I had somebody that had called me. They had left the church, Pastor Dave, and they at one time was, dedicated. And they said they was. Well, and they said they left because nobody ever noticed their gift, or nobody ever lifted them up when they did what they did. They said, you know, it just seemed like nobody didn't come out of the way to appreciate me. And I told them, I said, God saw you. I said, God saw you. I said, and they said, well, and they went on. I said, was it not enough that God could see you? Even though you were in the back, wasn't it enough that God knew what you was doing? Now, I'm not telling you that we shouldn't encourage people. But I'm telling you that you should not be doing what you're doing as unto the Lord, because you want encouragement or to be sought out. The renewed mind has this dedication to exalt Jesus. Look what it does. Makes itself of no reputation, takes upon it the form of what? Everybody say servant. I got any servants down here at my Father's house? I'm coming to Honey Rock. I got any down at my Father's house? Hallelujah. Come on. Yeah, you ain't got to be ashamed. I ain't going to call you out. Amen. You can put your hand up. How many of y'all know that being a servant means you're willing to walk anywhere, everywhere, anytime, and do whatever it takes to be able to serve others? I'm talking about the power of transformation. I'm talking about a renewed mind. Now I come to Honey Rock. We got any servants at Honey Rock? Amen. Hallelujah. And how many of y'all know one of the greatest desires? I've had to do this, and I teach this apostolically. If people are looking to me, Brother David, to do everything at Honey Rock, they got the wrong apostle. I'm not doing everything. I ain't called to do everything. I can't do everything. If God wanted me to do everything, he wouldn't need none of y'all who come from Honey Rock with me. I just do everything. You got a calling and you got a responsibility as well. And you'll never grow up in God if the preacher has to do everything for you. He can't do all your praying. He can't do all your fasting. He can't do all the reading for you. Somewhere you're going to have to do it for yourself. Amen. Lights, praise God. But we take upon us the form of a servant. Hallelujah. Who wants to have that form? I said, who does? Over here. Any of y'all? What I'm finding out right now, especially, is that if we're going to reach communities and neighborhoods and see them changed, we're going to have some servants. I know you got them here, and I know we got them at Honey Rock, but we're going to have them. And let me show you something else in the same scripture of the renewed mind. This is the mind of Christ. And was made in the likeness of men. In verse 8. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself. Humility. And became obedient. Obedience. Even unto death. Even the death of the cross. Humility and obedience is being released in the midst of us right now. Is anybody learning humility? Oh boy. Isn't it sometimes a hard lesson? If you ain't saying no, then you ain't learning it. Did you know one of the extended words of humility is humiliated? Hello? Now, we don't like to talk about what I'm getting ready to talk about, but I'm talking about it anyway. I'm seeing that there's a humility that is being released today in many places that I'm going in the body of Christ, and is connected with obedience, carrying out things in humility through obedience that you prefer or you many times don't want to do. Hallelujah. Amen, chairs. How many of y'all know that humility is not needed when it's something you want to do? But when God gives you an assignment that you just don't want to do it. Anybody hear those lately? Well, I've hit some of them. And God says to you, humble yourself and do it as unto the Lord. Well, I mean, he had to work on me a few months back. Boy, he gave me an assignment. And it was in a religious territory where he sent me. And I'm going to be honest with you, I did not want to go. It just even the way they said God just bothered me. They wouldn't just say God, it had to be God. And when I got there, I told the Lord, I said, I can't take this. And he said, this is your assignment. He said, you share with them. And you share what I tell you to say. And you humble yourself. It was a learning experience, but it was a blessed one because two or three of the men that were there got some freedom. some of the assignments that you are going to be called to fulfill in the last days are going to be assignments that you and your flesh are not going to want to do. But you're going to have to do them anyway because you are a humble, obedient servant. In the process of saying that, there's going to be a word that God gives you that some people ain't going to want to hear. But God don't give you the word so that they like to hear it because you ain't tickling people's ears. You're supposed to be proclaiming what thus saith the Lord. So sometimes when people can't hear it, praise the Lord, I share it. How many of y'all know, preachers, that you are not the cook? You're just a waiter. He cooks it. You serve it. So I said to the Lord, what is one of the biggest obstacles of obedience? He said, when you have not humbled yourself to me, your flesh will fight the assignments many times that I give you. Even this one right here that you read right here with me, he became obedient unto death. And look at what it does, even the death of the cross. So we've taken a journey. What he first of all was called to do was to make himself of no reputation. Take upon him the form of a servant. Being found as a man, humble yourself and be obedient. Look at verse 9. This is where most people want to skip over verse 5, 6, 7, and 8 and jump to verse 9. Wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. People want to be promoted, but they don't want to go through the process of getting there. Hello? You look at a minister like your pastor and other pastors, Pastor Hugh and other men, Richard and Pastor Christian, and you look at them and say, praise God, that's what I want to start doing tomorrow. Well, you don't know the struggles and the pains and the places that they had to walk through for years. Oh, y'all think they don't? If you got to work with more than one person, you're going to have some struggles. You haven't seen the things that they've had to sacrifice, the things that they've had to do. I have some young ministers sometime, they'll call me. They're just starting out in ministry. I had one that called me from a Baptist church right close to where we was, and he said, praise God, Brother Jerry, the Lord spoke to me and told me that he wants me to spend a day with you. Well, I told him, I said, I don't do a lot of spending days like that. I'll pray and see what the Lord tell me. And he went with me for a little while, and it wasn't glorious. It was like, you know, ministering to the sick, casting out devils, releasing the anointing of God, being called names and being insulted and being, you know, railed on, those kind of things. And when we got through, he spoke to me at the end of the day. He said, man, what you do ain't very glamorous, is it? I said, no. I said, this is called ministry. He said, my idea of ministry was really preaching behind a pulpit and doing things like that. I said, you got the wrong concept. I said, yes, we preach behind pulpits, but a minister is a servant. Hello. So if he's called to clean a bathroom up, that's where he better get. Hallelujah. Let this mind be in you. And can I go also to say something here? He became obedient unto death. I want to say this because it's really strong in me. How many of y'all know that everything you do in the Christian walk ain't just zippity-doo-dah, what a just a happy, 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 happy time. I mean, y'all know that there are some days that you will be required to walk through places that are extremely difficult to get through. The body of Christ don't want to hear, but you see, somebody needs to read the backside of the contract that you signed. Because what it said is this. It says, regardless of what you're going through, he is still worthy to be praised. Regardless if the kids are listening or minding, he's worthy to be praised. And what I'm finding out right now is that God is calling his men and his women in the body of Christ to love him regardless of what they are going through. There's one thing I say about Pastor David. He had a song that he used to always talk about. I never lost my praise. And I'm telling you, he was the true reflection of it. I'd walk into a hospital room. He would be suffering, and I knew he was. And I'd say, how you feeling? And the first thing he'd say, praise God. Hallelujah. And the Lord is good. And I would know he'd be going through it. But see, what you are actually is what you are in the worst of the situations of your life. It's not what you are when you maybe are dancing and jumping and shouting. It's when ain't nobody else around and ain't nothing working right. That's what you are. Hallelujah. Glory to God. How many of y'all in this for the whole ride? You ain't getting out of the car. Come on, somebody. You ain't getting out. If it's raining, you still riding. If it's storming, you still riding. I know y'all don't have this down in Lenoir City. Yeah, you do. I know you do because I've been down here with you. I know y'all. I have sometimes pastors, people, when they're going through a little bit of difficulty, they stop coming to church. I'm talking about the power of transformation, y'all. They stop coming to church, and you'll call them on the phone, or you'll see them somewhere, and you say, I ain't seen you in a while. And first thing they'll say to you, I've just been going through a hard place. I just ain't felt like being at church. If there's anywhere you need to be when you're going through a hard place, is you need to run down to the church house. Amen. And what I'm learning over and over again, if I got a renewed mind and I'm living a transformed life, nothing is going to shape me from serving God regardless of what I go through. How many of y'all know that Jesus had every opportunity to quit, but he didn't? And God has highly exalted him, given him a name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Of things in heaven, things in earth, things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. But he had to walk through all of that to get this. And this is where God has called you and I for this last time. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 5. Hallelujah. I'm talking about a transformed life, the power of transformation. I'm talking about the renewed mind. Hallelujah. I made my commitment even stronger. Last year was a hard year, difficult year, challenging year. I buried 10 people out of my own family. 10. I did their funerals. It's one thing to have your loved ones die. It's another thing to stand preaching. I preached them. I believe I did a total of about 12 or 14 funerals last year. I saw people that were going on to be with the Lord, who I love with all my heart. And God began to ask me questions like these. Are you going to pull back? Are you going to turn back? Here's my answer to all those things. If there's anything I'm going to do now, is I'm going harder. That's what I'm doing. I'm going harder. I love to have the ministers that are with me. They are some of my greatest brothers, Pastor Dave. I love to have the ministers. But if every minister decided tonight that he wasn't going to serve God another day, I'm going all the way. I ain't got nowhere else to turn back to. Everything that I need is in Jesus. Come on, somebody. And everything that I have to have is in Jesus. And this ain't no turning back time right now. People tell me this, and I'm saying to those of you that have not made a firm commitment to God, now's your time. God's changed your time so that many who wouldn't be able to be here at night are now getting the opportunity. You know what it is? We're closer and it's later than we have ever known it since we have been believers. And I don't know about you. I ain't going to be like the five of the virgins. I ain't going to be like them, run out of all now. When the bridegroom is just about to get here. Ain't no time to run out of all now. If I'm ever going to be on fire, I'm going to be on fire now. If I'm ever going to be at church, I'm going to be at church right now. If I'm ever going to praise God, I'm going to praise God right now. If I'm ever going to testify, I'm going to testify now. If I'm ever going to preach the word, I'm going to preach it right now. My King is coming. Hallelujah. I said my King. I don't know if he's yours, but I know that he's mine. My King is coming. Ain't no time to run out of awe. Hallelujah. I'm going to pray more in the spirit. Prophesy every day. Speak in tongues every chance I get. Even when I'm on somebody's nerves. I'm going to praise him in the morning, at noon, and in the evening time. I'm going to dance when people don't want me to dance. Spin when they don't want me to spin. Jump when they don't want me to jump. Why? Because I ain't running out of no all. I'm not going to be lukewarm. I'm going to be red hot. I'm going to stay in his presence. I'm going to call on his name. I'm going to fast. I'm going to pray. I don't care if people say it don't take all of that. I'm going to give all of that anyway. I'm going to sound the trumpet. I'm going to sound the alarm. I'm going to go in season, out of season, every day. Ain't no time to get temporal now. That's why when I look at my brothers and I see brothers, I know that they've been around this 40. Some of y'all been saved 50 years. And you still wiring the presence of God on you. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. You still get excited when you get the Bible in your hand. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You still love to praise his holy name. Glory to God. You still, like Sonia here, get excited when you sing about him, when you hear his name. Y'all see how thrilled she is when she says the name Jesus? That's how it ought to be in the believer's mind, who is renewed by the power of God. Jesus ought not get old. Jesus ought not get stale. Jesus ought not be just take it or leave it. He should be the essence and the presence of your life everywhere you go and in everything you do. Hallelujah. Y'all know y'all not apologize because you're on fire for God. Let the people who got the problem do the apologizing. You stay on fire for God. And don't be ashamed of it. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Said don't be ashamed of it, know where you go. Be the same thing if me and you was out somewhere and you saw me and you come speak to me and you wouldn't be ashamed to know me. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. This is the day right here for the renewed mind to exalt him everywhere you go. I was invited to come to a function that was going to be discussing an educational thing that they were bringing into Knoxville. I was invited. Y'all hear the word invited? That means I didn't bust their party. They invited me. Well, praise God. I was going to be very nice at the little gathering. I wasn't saying hardly a word. Until they said this, they were talking about education and they didn't want a lot of the things that are associated with religion in it because that was really inflicting, I don't know if they said pain, but they said some kind of crazy word on people that didn't believe. Y'all, how many of y'all know our school system is in the shape it's in because they put God out? Did y'all know, some of y'all don't remember because you're too young, but did you know that when a lot of us that are older went to school, we used to have an assembly where we actually had Bible study and the reading of the scripture, and you could say Jesus' name out loud. Y'all remember that? Well, I'm in this, and I'm still not saying anything, and then one of them said, wrong thing. They said this. And I don't know why they do this unless they know you're a preacher and they just want to really just provoke you. And then they said these words. They said, well, you know, anyway, the Bible that many of the religious people go by is full of contradictions anyway. That's it. We ain't going no farther. And the one that said it, I just sat there and I said this. I said, show me one contradiction in the Bible. They said, what? I said, you just said that the Bible is full of contradictions. I said, show me one. And they said, well, I can't quote one right now. I said, because you don't know none. I said, you don't know one, so therefore you are speculating what you said. I said, I want to tell y'all, and now, it's go for it now. I'm declaring war now, okay? I said, I want to tell you, every word my father spoke is true. And then I started quoting Isaiah 55. Not a word that he spoke will come return unto him void. Everything that he said will come to pass. Everything that he proclaimed will happen, and it'll be just like he said. I said, if you don't think it is, every prophecy that he's ever said, many of them are fulfilling themselves before your eyes right now. I just preached for about 10 minutes. Hallelujah. And then finally, one of them spoke up and said, amen. Hallelujah. Only thing I didn't do is take up an offering. I preached that long, but what I'm trying to get you to understand, the renewed mind doesn't put places that he's going to magnify the Lord. I'm glad I'm surrounded with some wow, out of the box, peculiar, overboard, fired up prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers of the word of God. Don't want to hang out with ministers that don't like to pray in public places. Hallelujah. If I ever go out with you, you don't want to pray in a public place, I'm going to pray even more at the place then, so that we can break those demonic holes that might be on your life. If Jesus is worth magnifying here, he should be worth magnifying every place you go. No reservations. Hallelujah. Praise God. Where am I at? Peter? Okay. Let me read this to you. We got baptism service too. Hallelujah. How many of y'all going to be baptized? Raise your hand, would you? One, two, three, four. Any more? All right, five, okay. Probably going to be some more. Like Brother Dave said, if you want to come up here and jump in the water with us, even if you ain't brought no clothes with you, amen, we've had that happen before. Hallelujah. I'm talking about, I want to walk with a transformed mind. Anybody in here? Want to give God glory. Want to give him praise. Hallelujah. Come to my house. Praise God, we're going to give him some praise. See you out in the parking lot, we're going to give you some praise. Hallelujah. Somebody asked me a few weeks ago over in Amvet's parking lot, and they saw me, and they was leaving. We talked for a little bit, and they said, keep me in your prayers. I said, let's start right now. Cars drive by everywhere. I said, come on, get me in my hands. Get me in them hands right here. They said, they looking around. I said, no, don't worry about that. I said, let's go ahead and pray right out here. See, if your mind has been renewed and you're living a transformed life, first of all, your dedication is to the Father. It doesn't matter what people think about you. It's, do I bring glory and praise to Jesus? Hallelujah. I got any people like that? How about over here? I got any over here like that? Amen. Praise the Lord. You sold out all the way in. No turning back. No backing up. No straddling the fence. Going hard for him. I knew that crowd know what hard is. Amen. How about you right here in the middle? No turning back. Love him with all your heart. He's worthy to be praised on Monday the same way he was on Sunday. You glorify him. You don't care if people see the Bible in your car, tracks falling out of your pocket, or a New Testament in your shirt pocket. He's worthy to be praised, worthy to be honored. Well, let me step over here. How about over here? I got any over here on fire for God? Love him with all your heart. Glorify him with your life. Done stepped over the line. Done crossed over the line. Going all the way for him. Glory. Oh, I feel that. Hallelujah. Because when I'm renewed in my mind, I'm transformed in my walk. It doesn't matter where I'm at. Because this is the position that I want you to see. 1 Peter chapter 5. If you're there, say amen. Verse 6. Hallelujah. Then we're going to do some praying, because somebody may have come tonight. Maybe you're in a backslidden condition, or maybe you don't even know that Jesus is Lord and Savior. Or maybe somebody has come tonight, maybe that fire that used to burn so strong in you has began to simmer down. So you're in the right place for the fire to be started once again. Hallelujah. I made up in my mind, going harder in 2015 than I ever gone in 37 years. Y'all hear what I'm saying? Going harder than I have in 37 years. Going harder in 2015. And I ain't going to apologize for it. Glory to God. I ain't going to apologize. Me and Janice out, if we're out eating somewhere, and praise God, I get the chance to minister, she knows I'm taking off. Eat you some soup while I go for it. Because I'm getting ready to release the anointing and the power of God. And thank God, ain't no being no ashamed, and ain't no being no timid about it. If Jesus is who he says he is. See, I refuse to praise God in a church house and don't give him that kind of glory outside the church house. It ain't real. The only place you dance is in church. It ain't real. If it's real, it'll all be at home. Hallelujah. Y'all have your little place in your house. You turn your little music on. Let it go all out through your house. Now, 1 Peter 5, and I'm going to close right here. Humble yourselves. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. Verse 7. Casting all your care upon him, for he what? How many of you believe that Jesus, that God cares for you? Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, didn't say he was, it says as, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. I found the way to keep the devil from devouring me. I found the way. Everybody ready? Ready for this great revelation? You punch first. Oh, y'all didn't hear what I said over here, huh? Don't be waiting on the devil to punch you. You punch first. It is quite difficult for somebody who is under a barrage of licks to hit me with one. So I don't wait for the devil to set the battle in array when I get up in the morning. I set the battle in array. I announce I'm up. And I announce that this is going to be a disastrous day for you. Before he can throw one lick at me, I pronounce this is going to be a tormenting day for every demon that is in this area. You should have not even come by this place. When I hear people tell me the devil's on my back, I know that they're running. I know they are, because if he's on your back, he's coming up from behind. He ain't gonna be on my back. I want face-to-face frontal contact, because I know that name that you were singing earlier, I know that he paid every price that could be paid. You know where we're standing at today? We're standing in a finished victory that Jesus has already accomplished for me and you. His blood already made me victorious. I ain't being victorious. It's already made me that way. Now think about what we got. We got the blood, we got the word, we got communion, we got the Holy Spirit, we got the 9 gifts of the Spirit, 7 gifts of motivation, 5-fold ministry, 66 books. We've got all of these things available to us. We got power, we got the baptism of the Holy Ghost, speaking with other tongues. We got the name of Jesus that is above every name. We got the word of God that dispels demons every time we speak it. And if that ain't enough, we got angels encamped around about us on every side that are keeping us. How are you going to tell me that you ain't victorious? Did you know that we're carrying and we have been giving access to more than any generation that's ever been alive? Look what it says in verse 9. It's talking about the devil here. Who resists steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. Verse 10, but the God of all grace, how many of y'all been saved by it? Delivered by it? Set free by it? How many of y'all call it still amazing? How sweet the sound. What did it do? And tell that person beside you, and you too, if you say. But the God of all grace. Now, most people don't read this verse right here. But I want to show you something. Who has called us into his eternal glory by Christ Jesus. After that you have suffered a while, make you perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. Do y'all see the last part of it? So here's what I want to tell everybody. If you're going through a time of suffering, that's not the end of the journey. Oh, yeah, you didn't hear what I'm saying. People talk about what they're going through, but this doesn't say that's going to be the condition that it's going to be. You're going to come through that, establish, strengthen, and settle. Let me give you one more scripture to prove it. Turn to Romans chapter 8. Hallelujah. Then we'll shout a little bit, and we're going to pray, and I believe that we're going to get ready under Pastor David's announcement. We're going to get ready to do some baptizing. Amen. Hallelujah. Some people talk to me about this, Pastor David, and I thank you so much at my Father's house for opening up the baptism of poo for us to be able to do this. It is still heated, isn't it? Go, thank you, Jesus. I have favor, glory. It felt so good last time. I have favor. I know, pastors, I know we baptized in cold ice water. Well, we seemed like we did that one time. It was kind of cool somewhere we were. But praise God. Oh, her, I remember. Hallelujah. I want to read this to you. Because the last part said he'll strengthen, settle you, and establish you. We walk through things, but that's not where we stay. Because of the renewed mind, we understand that where I'm at today does not mean I'm going to be here tomorrow. Verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Romans 8, 35. Shall tribulation? Answer. Shall distress? Shall persecution? Shall famine? Nakedness? Peril? Our sword. You just said no to all of those. You say none of that can separate you from the love of Christ. Is that right? So if none of that can separate you from the love of Christ, you win because you still got Christ. As it is written, for thy sake, we are killed all the day long. We are accounted, didn't mean we are, as sheep for the slaughter. No, in all these things, we are. Now, I'd like to include you. But we are. I am more than a conqueror through him that loved us. Anybody here fit their position? For I am persuaded. Y'all see how Paul left you? Look at what he said. For who's persuaded? See, persuasion cannot be somebody else carrying it for you. Your persuasions are based on your choices, your decision. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I want you to notice what he says. He said, I'm persuaded that death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, things present or things to come. I'll tell you something that I've been telling our people at Honey Rock. If you're going to tell me what the devil is doing to you, you're going to tell me more what God has done for you. Amen. You ain't just going to have the whole conversation with me talking about how the devil's going to beat you up. You're going to have to give Jesus more time. And I've learned something, and I'm not knocking anything that maybe you're doing, but I've learned something. People who spend the majority of their time talking about the devil and what he's doing to them energize him to do even more to them. Has Jesus done anything for you? Did Jesus set you free? Did he save you? Did he raise you? Did he heal you? Did he deliver you? Did he provide food for you? Did he save you and save some of your household? Many more are going to get saved. Did he wake you up this morning? Did he have you in a sound mind? Did he keep car wrecks from killing you? Did he keep you from being destroyed by the enemy? If God did that much for you, why can't you give him some praise?